to welcome in the new year at Stalingrad, the Soviets celebrated by firing their artillery at the Germans. The Germans didn't have enough ammunition to spare to fire back, so they fired flares into the air as makeshift fireworks. And, effective on the 1st of January 1943, the Stalingrad Front was renamed as the Southern Front. It now gave up the 62nd, 64th and 57th armies, handing them all over to Rokossovsky's Don Front. Yeremenko went on to command the 2nd Guards, 51st and 28th armies to the south, and for the first time, all the forces surrounding the 6th Army were now commanded by one general. Of course, Yeremenko would be upset that he had not been given command of the forces that would destroy the 6th Army. "We are not high school girls, we are Bolsheviks, and we must put worthwhile leaders in command." Meanwhile, the other dictator was informing his subordinate, "Every man in the 6th Army can start the new year with the absolute conviction that the Führer will not leave his heroic soldiers on the Volga in the lurch, and that Germany can and will find a means to relieve them." Faith in the Führer remained firm, even though these words were wrong. The southern portion of the Eastern Front was under threat. Stalin was now thinking that Rostov was back on the table, as was the idea of trapping and destroying Axis forces in the Caucasus. Over the next few days, he ordered the start of Operation Dawn, with the aim of taking Rostov and a host of other cities. The German and Hungarian Second Armies were also about to be targeted as well in the Voronezh-Kharkov offensive, but this wouldn't begin for a while. On the 2nd of January, Fiebig pulled his planes out of Morozovsk airfield, where they had returned a few days previously, and the transports were now operating from Salsk and Novocherkassk, which was near Rostov. I know it doesn't look like it on this map, but this was even further away than Salsk was due to the curvature of the earth. Worse, with Army Group A retreating from the Caucasus and Army Group Don in trouble, Fiebig knew he would have to evacuate Salsk as well. Preparations were being made for a new airfield to be constructed north of Rostov. And the Romanian 4th Army, or what was left of it, was disbanded on the 3rd of January. A single division was later formed from the remnants of the two former Romanian armies, which just goes to show how many men the Romanians had lost. And I think it's fair to say that what was happening outside the pocket at this point is now largely irrelevant to the story of Stalingrad. So while I will continue to give some broad statements about things going on elsewhere, really our focus will now be on what was happening at Stalingrad. On the 4th of January, Chistikov's, Batov's and Zadov's armies attacked a series of hills on the western and northeastern sides of the Stalingrad pocket, testing the defences. The 29th Motorized Division repulsed most of the attacks, with the 16th Panzer Division stopping 1-2, showing that the Germans weren't out of steam yet. In Stalingrad City, Oberstleutnant Brandt and General Steinmetz were both wounded by a single, random mortar shell. Brandt was killed instantly, but Steinmetz survived and was flown out of Stalingrad on the 8th, spending the next 9 months in hospital. On the 5th, another test was conducted on the western defences before a large attack came in on the 6th. The 214th Rifle Division took some ground against the 44th Infantry Division, creating a small breach in the line, and the 116th Rifle Division attacked, driving a wedge into the German defences held by 16th Panzer Division, itself too weak to actually do anything about it. The Germans were too weak now to dig new trenches in the frozen earth, showing that the lack of food was having a significant impact. "Army starving and frozen, have no ammunition and cannot move tanks anymore." Inside Stalingrad, the timed explosive charge the Germans had set in House 83 before abandoning it to the Soviets went off. Unfortunately, due to an accident on the Soviet side where a deputy commander had accidentally detonated his own grenade, the building had been evacuated. Thus, the huge explosion destroyed the house, but didn't have much of an impact on the Soviets because they weren't in it. Also on this day, the 79th Infantry Division was effectively disbanded. Its headquarters staff flew out of the pocket on the 8th and 9th of January, while its regiments were turned into battalions. These were consolidated into the 212th Grenadier Regiment and subordinated to the 305th Infantry Division. Its artillery regiment remained, but that was already depleted anyway, and also subordinated to Steinmetz. Thus, another division was now gone. It was that cold overnight and into the 7th that one man reported that mice had eaten two of his frozen toes while he was asleep. Soviet tanks were moved in to widen the gap in 44th Infantry Division's lines, forcing Heitz to use up precious fuel by sending 177th Sturmgeschütz Battalion to plug the gap, along with a battalion of infantry, each from two other divisions and other elements. On the 8th, General Huber visited Manstein's headquarters after seeing the Führer. He told Manstein that Hitler had sent a message for the 6th Army saying, "Hang on, I'll get you out." Manstein wasn't happy with this because he knew it was a false promise and supposedly didn't forward it on. Nonetheless, Huber did fly back into the pocket on this day, as the 44th Infantry Division reported that it had lost 480 men in the last 3 days of fighting. This couldn't go on, and Rokossovsky now issued an ultimatum to the 6th Army demanding their surrender. After contacting Hitler, Paulus rejected the offer, since again it wouldn't be good if 7 Soviet armies were released and sent west. However, the Soviet offer still convinced the Germans that the next Soviet offensive would strike on the 9th, even though it wouldn't. Operation Ring would actually commence on the 10th of January, and the initial attack would be conducted on the western face of the Stalingrad pocket, specifically in the area of the 44th and 29th Motorized Divisions. Once through the lines, they would race off to the Karpovka area to meet up with the other Soviet forces coming from the south. Thus, German forces would be cut off in a new pocket to the west, making them easy prey for a subsequent attack. Rokossovsky's Don Front had received 20,000 replacements, but the average strength of his rifled divisions was about 5,900 men, with 65th Army's averaging 7,000. While weak on paper, in reality the 3 Soviet armies in the west were only designated to attack 1 German division each, and therefore had significant local superiority. 14 rifled divisions and 8 Guards tank regiments, a total of 50,000 combat riflemen and 138 tanks, would strike 44th Infantry and 29th Motorized Divisions with less than 10,000 combat troops, 32 Panzers and 16 Stugs. Most of the Soviet tanks were also heavy KVs as well, although notably there were 21 Churchill Mark IV tanks in the 47th Guards tank regiment. If these ratios were not sufficient, Vorarov organized an overwhelming storm of artillery fire to fall on the heads of the defending Germans. 50 artillery regiments, 2 Katyusha divisions, yes, divisions, and 9 mortar regiments plus 17 tank destroyer regiments brought the total artillery and mortars to 6,860. Concentrated on a 9 to 12 kilometer wide front. To say that this was overwhelming is an understatement. On a front of 12 kilometers, this resulted in an artillery density of 202 guns and mortars per kilometer of front, the highest concentration of artillery achieved thus far in the war. They also had 400, or maybe 600, operational aircraft, of which 150 were fighters, meaning that the rest would be bombers, smashing the German forces and adding to the carnage. Overall, in the area of attack, the Soviets had an 8-to-1 ratio of manpower, 5-to-1 in armour and 20-to-1 in artillery. This was achieved partly by employing 6 fortified regions, which took up 40% of the front, allowing Rokossovsky to redeploy forces to the offensive sectors. As Glantz points out, in some areas the Germans actually outnumbered the Soviets, but the fortified regions had allowed the redeployment of the offensive units to the west, giving them superiority there. The question some of you might have is, why were they attacking mainly from the west? Why didn't they strike from north and south and split the pocket in two?
The first reason is because the Balkas in the pocket tended to flow from west to east. So if they had attacks from the north and south, they would have had to contend with numerous obstacles. But the main reason was because of the failure of the Kotlaban offensives to bash through the northern positions. It was simply too risky to strike in the north. Plus, it would require a major regrouping of forces. So overall, it was a better and safer bet to just go from west to east. There was a fear that the retreating Germans would pile into Stalingrad, and then advance into Chuikov's 62nd Army, possibly throwing him into the Volga. So Rokossovsky went to see Chuikov in order to discuss this possibility. Krylov's reply was simple. If the Germans couldn't defeat them in the summer, they wouldn't move six steps closer to the Volga now. Chuikov affirmed this, saying that Paulus's pocket was now little more than a camp full of prisoners. By the 9th of January 1943, 6th Army's ration strength was 197,034 men, with another 5,502 wounded, waiting to be airlifted away. This is the last known strength return for the whole army because Operation Ring started on the 10th, and the situation became so dire that there was no way to get accurate reports. But what this statistic suggests is that they had probably already lost at least 50,000 men at this point, which is a staggering number. It's possible that many were surrendering, but considering most of these losses must have been in the rear services troops, this places doubt on that explanation. Perhaps they were just killed by artillery fire, or maybe more people were flown out of the pocket than officially recorded, which is highly probable given the chaotic nature of the airlift. It's worth noting as well that, since the 6th Army had forbidden the mention of starvation up until late December, we have evidence that some deaths by starvation were being recorded as killed in action. So maybe this accounts for that number, but yeah, 50,000 had already perished by this point. Regardless, it's safe to say that even though 200,000 men remained within the pocket, the combat portion of that number was tiny. But they were making up for it by employing rear services troops as frontline infantry. Seydlitz had trained 4,088 rear servicemen as replacements, and now had 7,500 men, meaning he would have only had 3,400 men had he not done this. A source from the 16th Panzer Division says that the amount of rear services men deployed as infantry could be estimated at about 70,000 to 80,000 men, which is far higher than many of the secondary sources suggests, but it could be true. Either way, the quality of the frontline units was still deteriorating.
Wooster, the guy who had flown back into the pocket in December as a result of some sort of sense of duty, said this. Commanders of intact units like myself were ordered time and again to release men for use as infantry. We could not refuse, so what we did was not send our best men, but instead the weak and the troublemakers, who are in all units. I actually felt sorry for them, but it was my obligation to keep the battery fighting fit for as long as possible. Huber also reported to Paulus that the Führer was planning a second relief attempt. Paulus perked up over this, at least initially, but the other men who knew Huber were disappointed that he had fallen for Hitler's empty promises. In reality, a second relief attempt would not come in time, because time had just run out. At 08:05 hours Moscow time on the 10th of January 1943, a huge artillery barrage, one of the most intense of the war so far, began to pound the lines of the 6th Army. Such was the intensity that the 176th Cycle Section attached to the 203rd Infantry Regiment of 76th Infantry Division reported that some of its squads were entirely wiped out. During this time, there occurred in the battery position a regrettable incident. In a bunker next to the captured guns, two boxes of charges ignited and the whole bunker crew burned to death. An hour later, the Soviet attack started as 11 Soviet rifle divisions assaulted the 44th Infantry and 29th Motorized Divisions. The 179th Cycle Section was basically annihilated, with hardly anyone surviving. The German 29th Motorcycle Battalion, holding Hill 129 in the centre of 29th Motorised Division's lines, faced off against the 51st Guards, 293rd and 277th Rifle Divisions, plus the 1st Guards Tank Regiment with 16 tanks, 12 of which were KVs. It's no wonder the hill fell within an hour. Both sides admit, though, that heavy casualties were inflicted upon the first wave of the assault, and Soviet accounts praise the stubborn Germans for their resistance, which is surprising considering most of the German battalions were down to 300 men or less in some cases, and the lack of ammunition meant that only 5 artillery guns from the 44th Infantry Division were permitted to fire. But after the initial assault, things started to move as the Germans ran out of ammunition. The 21st and 65th Armies crashed through the 29th Motorized and 44th Infantry Division's lines, turning the flank of the 76th Infantry Division. Such was the ferocity that 6 entire battalions disintegrated, with one of the battalion commanders taking his own life. The Soviets also rolled through 6 more battalions from the 44th Infantry, which then had to fight in encirclement and try to escape east. The Germans did send in reinforcements, which included construction companies and observation units, as well as a handful of real combat battalions and some panzers, but these were too little to do much. Plus, the Soviets even committed their own reinforcements, sending in the 84th Rifle Division to assist the 214th. A blocking position was set up around the village of Dmitrievka, but despite some local successes, the German lines were broken. Huber had to shift all his reserves from 3rd Motorized Division to assist the 29th Motorized Division, which wasn't good because this left 3rd Motorized Division vulnerable. They had to pull back overnight from Marianovka, fearing encirclement if they didn't. German casualties were heavy, but weren't counted from this point on, so it's not possible to say exactly how many they had lost. Yet, this wasn't the only attack. In the south, 64th Army also struck, with some help from the 57th Army. They didn't get very far because they were attacking across a river and into a decent natural defensive position. Nonetheless, the German and Romanian lines were penetrated in several places, and some were encircled in the village of Zbenka. 4th Army Corps had thrown in all of their reserves, but these weren't enough to plug the gaps. The danger for the 6th Army was that, if Jenecke's corps collapsed, there was no real defensive terrain behind it. In the west, the Germans could retreat to the Rzeszowska, but there was nothing like that in the south. So if they lost the line they were currently on, this would compel all of the 6th Army to fall back into the Stalingrad area, losing every airfield they had, which obviously would be bad. The southern attack, therefore, was as alarming as that in the west. In Stalingrad itself, several of Chuikov's divisions and brigades also attacked, and since the Croatians had next to no ammunition left, they were quickly overrun. The last building in the Red October factory was recaptured by the 45th Rifle Division, while the 39th Guards Rifle Division advanced fairly well into the village. Batyuk's 284th Rifle Division took the summit and water tower of Mamiev Kurgan. However, in all other areas, 51st Army Corps put up a strong fight and gave little ground. Dragon was also ordered to move to the Red October factory, leaving Pavlov's house garrisoned by only a handful of men, something that many of the histories just forget. As the 6th Army was burning, madness seems to have taken over. Captain Issel of the 71st Infantry Division played the piano. After each piece by Beethoven, Bach and Schubert, General Hartmann would read selections of works by Goethe, Frederick the Great and Hitler. Paulus, meanwhile, sent a message to Manstein stating that a breakout attempt was now no longer possible, and that the critical supply situation had reduced his army's ability to resist. Another attack would overwhelm his men, and he needed several more battalions with weapons right now to stave off defeat. He must have known that such reinforcements were not coming, as even Manstein admitted,
there wasn't a spare battalion to send, nor would it have been wise to sacrifice more men at Stalingrad, since it had become clear by now that the end was near.
Overnight and into the 11th of January, Rokossovsky and Voronov assessed the progress so far and were disappointed. They had expected to have gotten further by now, and decided that the best course of action was to try and encircle the 3rd Motorized Division plus elements of the 29th in the Marianovka salient. Thus, in the morning in the 76th Infantry Division's area, a heavy fight occurred for a hill and a farm, and contact was temporarily lost with the 44th Infantry Division. But 7 German battalions and some Stugs managed to hold on against 3 Soviet rifle divisions plus elements from a 4th. That's because this was only the flank of the Soviet advance. The Soviet divisions to the south of there pushed on to the Reshoshka River. Under immense pressure, Kampfgruppe von Lossow pulled back, losing contact with the 29th Motorized Division, now forced to fend for itself. The Germans only had a few battalions, a handful of armoured vehicles, and some 88s to fight back with, and so stood no chance. Armed with British Churchill tanks, 47th Guards Tank Regiment struck towards Novo Alexeyevsky, but was hit in the flank by the 6 remaining tanks of 3rd Panzer Battalion plus stubborn infantry resistance, and lost 17 of its 21 Churchills. It was for this action, plus others, that made Hauptmann Hein receive the oak leaves for his Knight's Cross. Still, actions like this only delayed the inevitable, and the Germans had to withdraw, leaving their anti-tank guns and artillery behind. All spare fuel went to the few remaining panzers to keep them operational. In the Marianovka salient, 3rd Motorized Division and 2/3 of 29th Motorized Division now conducted a staged withdrawal. They left some forces behind in order to slow the Soviet assault, but these were quickly wiped out. Surprisingly, when the 52nd Guards and 120th Rifle Divisions attacked from the south, they were actually beaten back by the 3rd Motorized Division, showing that the Germans weren't beaten yet. In the south, 64th Army didn't go very far because Shumilov had ordered reinforcements to be brought up and put into action the next day, so only small advances were made here. And inside the city, Chuikov's forces continued to press forward slowly, although a machine gun artillery battalion had relieved the 138th Rifle Division, allowing it to move to the area east of the Red October factory and attack from there. A gap now formed at the left wing of the 100th Jaeger Division, compelling the 305th Infantry Division to fall back to plug it. Worse, the 389th Pioneer Battalion was also ordered to move out of Stalingrad to Potomnik, and the 3rd Fortress Battalion was moved out as well. So Paulus was pulling forces from the city because of the crises elsewhere, which is why Paulus reported to Manstein that the army has no more reserves, with the comments underlined as emphasis. He also said that they only had 3 more days' worth of ammunition, and the troops were physically weak. Things were getting desperate. And so, by the evening, there was a breach in the line between the 297th and 371st Infantry Divisions, which nothing could be done about. 2 battalions and 6 companies were sent from the 6th Army's reserves, including elements from 9th Flak Division, 3 Stugs, some anti-tank guns, and 200 men from the 51st Army Corps, but this was simply not enough. The 371st Infantry Division had to disband 4 road columns and 3 infantry companies in order to generate more combat infantry for the front lines. 29th Motorized Division didn't even submit a report this day because it simply wasn't able to, and Huber couldn't report on the positions of it or the 3rd Motorized Division, the latter having only 11 panzers remaining. 5 more panzers were left behind because there was no fuel. The shortage of fuel and ammunition was catastrophic. Incapacitated patients who had been piled in trucks, which then ground to a halt, just froze to death in the open.
Yet, despite the dire situation for the Germans, they had been successful. Rokossovsky's armies were only just reaching their first day's objectives, so even in its weakened state, 6th Army had proven a tougher nut to crack than expected, although the shell was about to shatter.
On Göring's 50th birthday, the 12th of January, the Soviets dented the defences on the left wing of the 76th Infantry Division, pushing them and what was left of the 44th Infantry Division's right wing back 2 kilometres. To the south, 40 Soviet tanks and 4 divisions forced the Germans back to the Reshoshka River and seized a large bridgehead south of Novoalexeyevsky. To their south, 4 more Soviet divisions smashed the 29th Motorized Division and drove straight into the 3rd Motorized Division's rear. The men of 3rd Motorized Division, many of whom were still sat on their frontline positions, had to fight their way back east while being attacked from the north, west and south. Snow hampered their movements and many died in the chaos as the salient contracted. Worse, the 252nd Rifle Division reached the Reshoshka River, cutting off 29th Motorized Division's path of retreat, and the 51st Guards Rifle Division battled to take Karpovka, as all the German forces in the salient were now flooding through that village in order to escape the trap.
The Voroshilov camp was liberated, with the Soviets discovering the horrors within it. And Glantz estimates that the 2 German motorized divisions had already lost up to 2/3 of their original strength during this fighting, with 29th Motorized Division taking the majority of the damage. Paulus now suspected that these forces wouldn't be able to withdraw or form a new defence line along the river.
As Paulus and his commanders well knew, without a viable defence along the Reshoshka, the fortress itself would ultimately collapse from west to east, leaving the army's remnants trapped in the same cul-de-sac into which they had driven 62nd Army almost 7 months before. Such are the ironies of history. Compounding this irony, messages from the OKH to 6th Army remained incredibly disconnected from reality, as they had been since 19th November.
The OKH demanded to know why Zbenka had been evacuated without the Army High Command's permission, and ordered it to be retaken. It even pretended in its reports that the Soviet attacks had no success, and that the enemy were halted in some cases. It was totally out of touch. Paulus tried to explain, but he didn't have any concrete details since the 14th Panzer Corps hadn't submitted its reports, leaving Paulus in the dark. The 8th Army Corps was also not sure what was going on with the 44th Infantry Division, because it too was preoccupied with its own survival and also didn't submit reports.
News of Soviet tank attacks now caused panzer fright in German ranks. There were hardly any anti-tank guns left with ammunition. Nobody had time to reflect on the way they had despised the Romanians for just such a reaction 2 months before. In 64th Army's area, the 29th Rifle Division had been given as reinforcements, allowing Shumilov to expand his bridgehead. Tolbukhin's attacking forces also advanced, and the pocket of Zbenka fell to the 422nd Rifle Division. The canning factory was also taken by 154th Naval Rifle Brigade. To add to the Germans' misery, 4th Army Corps reported that it only had 2 panzers left, and these were now immobile due to a lack of fuel. In the north of the pocket, the 16th Panzer Division had suffered under attacks from Zadov's 66th Army for the past couple of days, although the Soviets hadn't gotten very far. Nonetheless, the attack had worn down the Panzer Division to such an extent that a small advance was made on this day, and with just 9 panzers left, it was clear that they would have to withdraw further due to the attrition that they had suffered.
Inside the Stalingrad pocket over the previous day and this one, it had been realised that the Croatian Legion was now on its last legs. Despite the need for every available combat infantryman on the front line, the handful of Croatians left, barely a company of 40 men, were ordered to pull back, probably to preserve them. They were formed into work details to create fallback positions for the other units, and Oberst Pavicic was flown out of the pocket shortly afterwards, or died trying to, it's not clear. A few other Croatians did manage to leave the pocket, which is why their war diary survived, and the Croatian artillery would continue to operate in support of the 100th Jaeger Division until the 24th of January. But otherwise, the unit was effectively disbanded as a combat formation and will now be removed from the map. I will encourage you one final time to read the book Croatian Legion by Jason DeMark for the full history of this doomed unit. It's well worth it.
Chuikov's men pushed past the outbuildings of the bread factory and the rubbled streets west of the Red October factory. Ludnikov's division openly reported that they had killed the prisoners that they had taken from Munch's 3rd Battalion, which is a testament to the brutality of the fighting. "German soldiers, drop your weapons. It makes no sense to continue. Your Captain Munch will also realize one day what is going on. What this super fascist tells you isn't right anyway. He will recognize it. One day we'll seize him." The sources don't say how Captain Munch managed to collect 6 of the Chaos Emeralds, but apparently he had.
By this point, the 6th Army had lost about 2/3 of their anti-tank guns, which is obviously not good when you realise that most of these were lost in the west. Most of the remaining guns were in other sectors of the pocket. Therefore, the Western Front had next to no anti-tank capability left, and this just shows how bad the fuel and fodder situation for the 6th Army had been. The guns were just left where they stood, and therefore were lost in the retreat. Now, to be fair, the Soviets had also lost about half of their original tanks. Again, the 47th Guards Tank Regiment had all but 3 of its 21 Churchill tanks knocked out, so the Germans had put up fierce resistance, even if it had cost them dearly. But the fact is that the Soviets still had tanks left, and the Germans had next to no anti-tank capabilities now, and no ammunition. Still, the 6th Army's commanders didn't just give up, they considered their options. Could they build a defence line somewhere to the east of the Reshoshka? Could they attempt a last-minute desperate breakout? Or was there some other possibility that they hadn't considered? The fact that they were even contemplating a breakout at this point shows just how desperate they had become. The main German front lines were now about 400 kilometers away, and that's not a nice trek even in summer on a full stomach. It's not clear exactly when this happened, but around this time the airfield at Salsk came under attack. This forced the Ju-52s to evacuate to Zvero, which had a runway made of packed snow on farmland, and the staff and crews had to live in igloos and tents, all of which made the airlift even more difficult. Apparently, many of the wounded lying at the airfield of Potomnik were now not being fed because, it's speculated, local officers had decided that all supplies had to go to the combat troops, and a wave of rumours spread throughout the German rear area, including one that a group of tanks was headed towards Potomnik. According to William Craig, one T-34 made it to the airfield, causing panic to erupt. Whether this tank existed or not isn't clear, but what is clear is that the men scrambled in panic to get on the planes, even throwing off cargo and devouring any food they found. Many were trampled underfoot, until it was realised that it was a false alarm. There was no Soviet tanks, and everything quietened down. And with Huber having failed in the face of Hitler, Paulus now attempted to send 2 officers out of the pocket in a desperate bid to get someone to listen. The first was General Pickert of the 9th Flak Division, and the other was a panzer crewman who had earned the Knight's Cross, Captain Vinrich Baer. He was handed 6th Army's war diary and made his way to Potomnik.
The runway was already under fire from heavy mortars as well as artillery. As Baer ran to the Heinkel 111 filled with wounded, the Feldgendarmerie, armed with submachine guns, had to hold back hundreds of others trying to rush or even crawl to the plane.
Deserters tried to access the planes as well, including Lieutenant Colonel Petzold from the 14th Panzer Division. He failed to get out, but the quartermaster of the 8th Army Corps persuaded the staff at Potomnik that he had to fly out the pocket to clarify some supply problems. And this ruse worked. Paulus heard about it though, and apparently he was court-martialed and shot. Baer first visited Manstein and reported everything, the famine, the casualties and the shortages. Manstein supposedly told Baer to give Hitler the exact same report, and the officer was bundled into another aeroplane bound for East Prussia. Being of the Luftwaffe, Pickert first reported to Fiebig, then to Richthofen, saying that the situation was critical and that everyone in the pocket was reduced to fighting with their last rounds. However, this only confirmed to both of his superiors that they had done their best and that it wasn't the Luftwaffe's fault. So Pickert requested that he return to Stalingrad to stand with his men, but Richthofen refused this.
Overnight and into the 13th, Rokossovsky and Voronov realized that resistance had been strongest against the 65th Army, and so decided to shift their focus to the south, 21st Army sector. Therefore, the 173rd and 252nd Rifle Divisions, plus nearly 20 artillery and mortar regiments and 6 tank regiments, were transferred from the 65th Army to the 21st Army. The overall aim now was to cross the Rzeszowska in the south by the 14th the next day, then strike towards Bytomnik on the 15th, and after that they would link up with the 57th Army. Thus, Chistikov's 21st Army attacked again on the 13th, easily taking Karpovka, where a bunch of women came out of their hiding places to search the German trenches for blankets and other goods. Many of the Germans hadn't gotten through, although Heinz Panzers had. Hein was wounded, and since he was a skilled officer, was flown out of Stalingrad along with another 2 members of his battalion. Another man flown out this day was Major General Nicolae Tataranu, the commander of the now disbanded Romanian 20th Division. But the main elements of the German 3rd and 29th Motorized Divisions were encircled to the northwest of Karpovka, at which point they were annihilated by 4 Soviet divisions. With the salient destroyed, 21st and 65th Armies pressed on to a new line south of Novoalexevsky, where they halted for a brief rest and refit. The other forces north of there also rested, but the damage done to the Germans in this area had been significant, as this report from within the 76th Infantry Division makes clear. All guns and vehicles, with the exception of 1 vehicle and gun, are lost. Company is deployed tactically as infantry. And 6 Army's quartermaster reported, "We have no more bread, munitions, and fuel." The airfield at Karpovka was lost, meaning that there were now only 4 operational airfields left, since Gumrak was where Paulus' HQ was, and thus wasn't in use. Still, the airlift was continuing, with 69 aircraft somehow delivering 224.5 tons, which is 3.24 tons per aircraft. They physically couldn't have delivered that many tons with that many aircraft, so something's off, especially since the day before it took 51 aircraft to deliver 61 tons, and the day before that, 95 aircraft to deliver 189 tons. Again, there are large discrepancies in the statistics. Shumilov's and Tolbukhin's armies advanced slightly, taking several strong points and hills from the 297th and 376th Infantry Divisions. This stretched the 4th Army Corps beyond breaking point, and in desperation, the 71st Infantry Division sent its 200-man strong 171st Bicycle Battalion to reinforce Jenniker's corps and recapture a hill, which was obviously not going to do much. Chuikov continued to fight with the 51st Army Corps over Mamiev Kurgan and the factory district, and at 21:50 hours, 51st Army Corps sent its final report, saying that it had repulsed an enemy raid in the bread factory. This would, in fact, be the last report in 6th Army's records from any of its corps. From now on, the Army's records contain only messages sent by 6th Army to Army Group Don or the German High Command. On the 14th of January, the Germans held on at the Barricade and Bread factories, and on Mamiev Kurgan. But the 45th and 138th Rifle and 39th Guards Rifle Divisions pressed forward up to 10 blocks into the lower Red October village. Outside the city, the 214th Rifle Division attacked Zapadnovka, but failed to take it, while the other units of the 65th Army advanced slightly. The 23rd and 304th Rifle Divisions crossed the Reshoshka River and enveloped 44th Infantry Division's forces defending Novoalexeyevsky, although failed to hold onto a hill just south of there thanks to General Laser, who personally led a counterattack on foot to recapture the hill that evening. You know things are desperate when a German general has to conduct an individual assault himself. With 65th Army keeping the Germans busy, this allowed the 21st Army to get across the Reshoshka River, reorganize and prepare for the next assault. The 96th and 120th Rifle Divisions advanced southeast about 9 kilometers, crossed the Karpovka River, then took more places beyond it. And at this point, the remains of the 3rd and 29th Motorized Divisions could barely even erect a security screen in the face of the Soviet forces confronting them. And to top it off, the 376th Infantry Division was attacked by the 15th Guards and 422nd Rifle Divisions as the rest of the forces in the south also advanced. The 376th Infantry Division collapsed under the pressure, and its remnants were encircled in a pocket. There, overnight, what was left of the division was wiped out. There was now a massive gap in the front, plus a 15-kilometer gap in the 297th Infantry Division's center and right wing, and another gap was also carved into the seam between the 371st and 297th Infantry Divisions, neither of which could close it as they were stretched too thin. Effectively, 4th Army Corps had no right wing or center. So yes, by the end of the 14th of January 1943, the western and southern parts of the 6th Army's pocket were broken. The 376th Infantry Division was gone, the 3rd and 29th Motorized Divisions could only provide the thinnest of lines to hold their sector, and the 44th Infantry Division wasn't much better off. The Reshoshka and Karpovka rivers had been crossed, and there was nothing left to reinforce the line with. Potomnik Airfield, the most important in the pocket, lay almost completely exposed, and so Paulus desperately searched for forces he could use to plug the gaps in his fronts, but there was nothing left. From this point on, only the extreme weather and desperate resistance by small, increasingly isolated groups of German forces prevented Paulus's entire fortress from disintegrating. In the evening, 6th Army admitted that the 3rd Motorized and 376th Infantry Divisions were completely broken, and that the men of these divisions were only fighting with their sidearms, such was the ammunition crisis. Paulus said that, since his entire western and southern fronts were broken, he had authorized a retreat. The only thing that could help now was more ammunition and food, which was not happening. And on this day, Oberst Rudolf Zichenicus from the 16th Panzer Division was flown out of the pocket, as was Oberst Willy Lankiet of 36th Panzer Regiment, 14th Panzer Division, although one source says that the latter was flown out on the 16th. There were others flown out about this time too, including Celestin von Zitzewitz, the guy Hitler had sent into Stalingrad with a radio in order to establish a direct connection with the 6th Army Command. And after suffering days of attrition, 16th Panzer Division and the 60th Motorized and 24th Panzer Divisions beside it were compelled to fall back overnight from the 14th to 15th to new defensive positions just north of Olovka.
"Kameraden, hold yourselves together. We don't have far to go. We have to leave stragglers behind. They'll freeze to death."
Operation Ring had not gone exactly to the Soviet plan. It had taken longer than expected to break through the German lines. However, there's no doubt that it had been successful. The 29th Motorized Division had been the best division in the 6th Army, and it had basically been destroyed in 4 days. One other division had been wiped out, and another motorized division was almost gone as well, and this is on top of another division that was disbanded before the operation had begun. Paulus had lost most of his anti-tank guns, was running out of panzers, and ammunition, and fuel, and there was no hope. Paulus's army was collapsing, and we'll see more of this collapse next time. Thanks for watching, bye for now.